Greetings. My name is Dr. Erica Cirillo McCarthy. I'm the director of the Margaret H. Ordobanian University Writing Center here at Middle Tennessee State University, and I've been invited to create two workshops for your genetics class. The first one is designing stellar research posters. So this workshop will cover the design elements and the things you need to consider as you create your research poster. First, I wanted to talk a little bit about the Writing Center. I want to invite you to consider bringing your research poster designs to the Writing Center. As you know, we work with writers at any stage of the writing process. We also have a 75-inch interactive screen that you can use to put up your research poster, build your research poster, and get feedback from tutors. Now, our tutoring sessions are 25 minutes or 45 minutes long. You can meet in person or online, and we'd be happy to work with you either on your research poster or on your elevator pitch or both to ensure that you are confident and ready to go with this assignment. Briefly, our fall hours, we're pretty much open every day until 8 p.m., except for Friday when we're open from 10 to 5, and Saturday when we are closed. Our physical location is in Walker Library 362, which is on the third floor directly above Starbucks. But I want to make sure I mention that we also tutor online. So if you work a lot or you have a lot of family obligations and you can't make it to campus to meet with a tutor, we can also meet you online in a Skype-like session. So the first thing I want to talk about is, are the elements of design, the things that you want to consider as you build your research poster. So first, three things. One, color. You want to think complementary and contrasting colors. So colors that are close to each other on the color wheel, but or across from each other on the color wheel. But you want to also take into consideration that some of your viewers might be colorblind. So how will they see some of these colors, and will they miss out on some of your design elements because of that? All of this is to say we should be inclusive in our design element decisions. Style. You want to consider fonts, what type of fonts you want to use, the size of your fonts. You also want to consider white space, and I'll talk about that briefly in a minute, and the use of images. So you want to create a kind of stylistic consistency throughout your research poster rather than disconnected sections. So the style is a way to kind of weave through a totality of your research poster design. Three, size. So when we think about size, we want to think about the size of our font, our images, our charts, logos, and our borders. So when we also think about our images, especially for your gene slides that you've created, we want to make sure they aren't too blurry, that they are crisp images, so that when they blow up into the 36 by 48 size that they will be on the screens in your genetics classroom, that they look really, really crisp. You want to make sure that this looks professional, and this is one way to do it. Now, three other things that we want to consider when we consider elements of design for research posters are movement. So our eyes move across research posters, but they move according to the how the author wants us our eyes to move. So where do you want the viewer's eyes to focus? What's the entry point into the poster? For this assignment, you're going to use a traditional newspaper column model research poster design. So most people will enter it via the abstract and kind of move along logically. But think about the location of your images and your charts. Where do you want them to be? How do they also support movement of the eye rather than inhibit a movement? Organization. In what order do you want viewers to encounter information? Now, because most of you will be using a very similar template, you don't have to worry about the organization of sections as much as you need to worry about the information within those sections. So again, we still want to consider the logical flow of ideas and how our viewer encounters that information. And then finally, proximity. How can you use the space to show relationships between ideas? Again, that's more so within the different sections. So if you have ideas that are similar, ideally they'll be closer together. If there's a relationship between ideas, one would follow the other. So all of these things you want to consider as you create your research poster. Other design elements to consider, your headlines, right? So your title and your section headings. Now you want to aim for statements instead of questions. I think declarative statements make a bigger impact. However, certain disciplines allow for questions. So you just want to double check with your professor if questions are okay. If they are, feel free. However, I would encourage most folks to aim for statements with your title and with your section headers. Pull quotes. So pull quotes are succinct quotes from the research that are set off from the rest of the text in large type. I have an example here in the lower right hand corner of the slide. So that would be a place for you to draw your reader's attention. This is important. I want you to take a look at it. This might not feature into your genetics research poster, but perhaps in future posters. Shapes. You want to consider mixing it up. When you look at your design, your poster template, it's going to be quite angular with right angles, very square, very rigid. It doesn't necessarily have to stay that way. Research has shown that humans love circles. So how can you bring in circles, whether that's through your images or some maybe perhaps some of the other ways that you're going to visualize the data that you have collected in this research project? And then finally, white space. You want to leave some cognitive breathing room. What does that mean? It means that between the sections or even within the different sections of your research poster, there's some white space for your viewer's eyes to land on, to give them that split second moment to just relax their brain. Imagine if you receive an email that's just a wall of text, you're not going to read through it. Your eyes glaze over it. You really don't intake any of the message. However, if there are breaks within the text, that gives you that cognitive breathing room to move forward, read more carefully and closely, and take in the larger message. All right, so here's the newspaper column model and design that I mentioned previously. This is a pretty standard scientific research poster and very close to what you're going to be asked to do in your genetics class. Some things that you want to consider, you want to stay in the present tense with your academic language when you're writing. And more importantly, when you're deciding what to put into your research poster, it can't just be interesting. Now, when we do research projects as complex as you've done in this class, it all seems interesting. I get it. However, when we present our research to our audience, we want to make sure it's relevant and can't just be interesting. It has to be interesting and relevant. You'll notice that this is a pretty standard research poster design, and there's a reason behind that. It's formulaic because it helps the viewer find the information that they're looking for in an efficient manner. So it's useful for your viewer to put it in this particular style and order. So imagine that if you're at a research conference, a scientific research conference, and the research poster session has maybe 20 to 30 different research posters. The only way you're going to get through all of them and glean some sort of information is to be able to know where to find, say, the abstract and the conclusion. And that will help you decide, do you want to read further or not? So there's a reason behind this convention and a reason why you're being asked to follow this particular convention. Here's an example of that newspaper column model that I just referenced. It's a really wonderful example because it's crisp, it's clear, it offers that white space, or in this case, some gray space in between the different sections. I have some play between text and images or charts that they have created for this. The reference section isn't in teeny, teeny, tiny font. In fact, it's in the same size font as the other sections. There might be a little problem in reading the usability checklist that's located at the bottom of the middle column. However, I think if we are viewing this on a larger screen, say on the screens in your genetics classroom where you'll be showing your research poster, you'll be able to see a complex chart like that. But I don't know if I would suggest you would have something so complex in your research poster. However, you can see the information is very clearly presented, it's easy to read, and it's easy on the eyes. Now, I wanted to bring in another example that brings in the design element of color. I find this much more dynamic and exciting to look at. I like colors. My eyes are drawn to the beautiful images of the fish, even the scatter plot chart that's in the middle there. They're drawing my attention. I'm interested into this. So if I saw this at a conference, I would go up to it, I would read the abstract, look at the images, read the discussion, and I would ask the presenter for more information. This is compelling to me. The other thing that is interesting to me is that the angles, I don't know if you've noticed, but for each section, the angles are softened a bit. They're not these hard right angles. And that also draws my eyes. I'm interested in looking at the different sections. Finally, there's plenty of white space or space in between text that give me that cognitive breathing room. So this is a really great example of a research poster that is dynamic and engaging and, more importantly, memorable. So as you noted from the past two examples, they have logos on it, and you will have to put logos on your research poster. I have two examples here. The MTSU bio logo that was provided to me by your professor, and they'll provide it to you as well. And then the Middle Tennessee State University logo that you can get on Creative Solutions page on the MTSU website. You would just request the logo and they would send it to you in your email in a JPEG. You don't want to take logos from websites. They will never look crisp. They will never resize right. They will look incredibly blurry. And that brings me to my final point here. When you are resizing the logo to fit, say, the upper right or left-hand corner of your research poster, please hold down the shift key when you're resizing it. That will ensure that it resizes to scale and it doesn't get blurry or distorted. So we finally come to our activity. I have a blank research poster template here. And what I invite you to do is print this slide out. What that will do is give you a kind of drafting space for you to take some time and consider where you want your text, where you want your images, slides, charts, all of those things in here. It's really useful to kind of plan it out using a template like this and handwrite it out rather than work on a PowerPoint that you'll download that will be the template that you build your research poster on, because you have much more freedom this way. And this is something that you can bring into the Writing Center and work with the tutor to kind of figure out where you think all of these different design elements and these different components of your research poster can go. As I end this workshop, again, I just want to invite you to come to the Writing Center, work with a tutor, use our interactive screen to build your research poster, and I just want to wish you all best of luck. Thank you.